The peritoneal cavity is divided into supracolic and infracolic compartments by the transverse colon. You could see this is the transverse colon. So above this is the supracolic compartment. Below this is the infracolic compartment. So the supracolic compartment boundaries are anteriorly anterior abdominal wall, posteriorly lesser omentum, stomach, transverse colon with greater omentum. So this forms the supracolic compartment. Here the supracolic compartment is divided by the liver into two spaces, that is suprahepatic space, and below the liver is subhepatic space, suprahepatic and the infrahepatic or subhepatic spaces. And we have these spaces on the right and also on the left side. And these spaces are below the diaphragm. You could see this is the below the diaphragm. That is where these spaces are called as the subphrenic spaces. Subphrenic spaces. So we have on the right side three spaces are there. On the left side three subphrenic spaces are there. Three on the right, three on the left. Among these three, right and left, among these three, two are the intraperitoneal spaces, whereas one is extraperitoneal space. Same way to the left also. Two intraperitoneal space and one extraperitoneal space. So let us discuss about the spaces on the right side. So we have right anterior intraperitoneal space. Anterior intraperitoneal space, also called as suprahepatic space. Suprahepatic space. Here the boundaries are anteriorly anterior abdominal wall. This is the, you could see here, this is the anterior abdominal wall and the diaphragm. Posteriorly, it lines the superior and anterior surface of the liver. And above, it is limited by the superior layer of coronary ligament. Superior layer of coronary ligament. Below, it is continuous down. And on the left side, this is limited by the falciform ligament. And on the right side, it is again continuous with the other or subhepatic space. It is continuous. So these are the boundaries of the suprahepatic space on the right side. Infrahepatic space or subhepatic space on the right side is, the boundaries are, you could see here, this is the subhepatic space. Anteriorly, you could see this is the inferior surface of the liver. Inferior surface of the liver. And posteriorly, this is the anterior surface of the right kidney and right suprarenal gland and the colic flexure. This forms the posterior boundary. And above, it is limited by the inferior layer of coronary ligament. Above, it is limited by the inferior layer of coronary ligament. And below, it is continuous with the right paracolic gutter. It is continuous with the right paracolic gutter. You could see this is the ascending colon. And on the right side, it is again continuous with the suprahepatic space. On the left side, it is continuous with the lesser sac through the epiploic foramen. So this is the subhepatic space on the right side. It is also called as hepatorenal pouch between the liver and the kidney. Hepatorenal pouch or the Morrison's pouch. So this is the most dependent. Now the right side, extraperitoneal space is there. That is the bare area of the liver. So you could see, I want to show you it here on the posterior aspect. This is the bare area of the liver. It is bounded above by the superior layer of coronary ligament and below by the inferior layer of coronary ligament. And the right side, it is continued as the right triangular ligament. The right triangular ligament. And on the right side, you have the inferior vena cava, groove for inferior vena cava. So this is the bare area of the liver. This is extraperitoneal space present behind. So this is the behind, this is the place where you see the bare area of the liver. So these spaces are all on the right side. Suppose coming to the left side, you have the suprahepatic space on the left side. This is the suprahepatic space. And the boundary, anterior boundary is the anterior abdominal wall. Posterior boundary is, you could see, this is the left triangular ligament. Left triangular ligament and then left lobe of the liver and stomach and spleen. They form the boundaries, posterior boundary. And above, it is formed by the diaphragm and below, it is open. So these are the boundaries of the suprahepatic space on the left side. This is again intraperitoneal. So we call it as a left anterior intraperitoneal space. Coming to the subhepatic space, or the posterior intraperitoneal space on the left side. This is nothing but the omental bursa. These are the boundaries of the omental bursa here. This is the sac present behind the stomach. And we have the extraperitoneal space present on the left side. So that is behind the bare area of the stomach. Anterior boundary is the bare area of the stomach. And posteriorly you have the diaphragm and then upper part of the kidney and suprarenal gland on the left side. So they become the small peritoneal, extraperitoneal space. So here we have clinical importance for these spaces for the lesser sac, because if there is any leakage to the ulcers present in the stomach on the posterior part, so that the fluids present in the stomach, they will be entering into the omental bursa, and then through the epiploic foramen they may reach the hepatorenal pouch, and then through the paracolic cutter it may enter into the pelvic cavity. So the infections are common if we have the peptic ulcers are present. Sometimes there is accumulation of fluid and seal the epiploic foramen, and in that case the fluid will be present inside the omental bursa and the stomach will be distended. At that time we have the drainage tube will be inserted into the omental bursa. So this is about the infections of the spaces, that is the supracolic compartment. So now coming to the spaces present in the infracolic compartment. So you have right and left paracolic compartments are there by the root of the mesentery. You can see this is the root of the mesentery. This is obliquely placed. So from the left side to the right side, right sacroiliac joint it extends, and left side it extends up to the L2, that is at the level of the junction between the duodenum and jejunum. So that forms a root of the mesentery. Because of the root of the mesentery, it is divided into right side and the left side paracolic compartment. So that if you observe the right paracolic compartment, the boundary on the right side is the ascending colon, on the left side is root of the mesentery, above is transverse colon. And if you observe here the apex, this space is triangular and apex is closed lower down, whereas base is transverse colon. And this is the right paracolic, we say that compartments. And then we have the left paracolic compartment. If you observe, you see here it is also triangular, but apex is upwards and base is down. So apex is towards the, if you observe here, towards the root of the transverse mesocolon, and base is here lower down. And on the right side you have the root of the mesentery, on the left side you have the descending colon. So this is a left paracolic compartment. These compartments are further divided by these colons into depressions or fossas called as paracolic cutters. So this is a left paracolic cutter, this depression. On either side of the descending colon you have the two paracolic cutters, left side medial paracolic cutter, left side lateral paracolic cutter. Same way we have the on the right side medial paracolic cutter, and this is a lateral paracolic cutter. So medial paracolic cutter on the right side, it is closed, that means if there is any infection also it cannot spread to the other spaces. Suppose if any infection is there and fluid collects in the lateral paracolic cutter on the right side, it may reach the pelvic cavity and also the hepatorenal pouch above. So except this medial right paracolic cutter, all the three paracolic cutters are continuous or communicate to the pelvic cavity down. Whereas if you observe this on the left side, only the fluid can go only to the pelvic cavity, not to the above, because it is limited by the root of the transverse mesocolon. And otherwise the lower down, the right left side medial and lateral paracolic cutters are continuous with the pelvic cavity. So you have these spaces present in the infracolic compartment. So these are the spaces present in the pelvic peritoneal cavity.